They called themselves Freedom Riders, a group of men and women, black and white, young and old, riding buses through the Deep South, their purpose to challenge head-on Jim Crow segregation laws.
They would be thrown in jail, mocked, beaten, and worse. This week, KCPT marks the 50th anniversary of the Freedom Rides with a landmark documentary that retells their story.
And we go on location to the Plaza Library, where we engage your friends and neighbors in a citizen conversation. Would you have gotten on that bus? And if you were to take a Freedom Ride today, where would you go?
Also on this week's local show, the Missouri organization on a quest to give 10,000 pairs of shoes 10,000 impoverished children in our own backyard.
Plus a quick glimpse at ferment taking root on the lawn at the Nelson Atkins Museum.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kaufman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Nick Haynes.
And I'm Randy Mason. Welcome to The Local Show. In May of 1961, more than 400 black and white Americans risked their lives and endured savage beatings and imprisonment for simply traveling together on buses as they journeyed through the Deep South.
This Monday night at 8 on KCPT, veteran filmmaker Stanley Nelson presents The Freedom Riders, the first feature-length film about this courageous band of citizens. In just a moment, we head to Kansas City's Plaza Library, where we've gathered almost 200 people to ask where they might take a Freedom Ride today.
But first, here's an extended excerpt from Monday night's documentary.
Boarding that Greyhound bus to travel through the heart of the Deep South, I felt good. I felt happy. I felt liberated. I was like a soldier in a nonviolent army. I was ready.
I'm on my way.
I'm sorry, our management does not allow us to serve niggers in here.
The Freedom Rides of 1961 were a simple but daring plan to put blacks and whites on commercial buses. They would deliberately violate the segregation laws.
These people are going from town to town and getting off the bus, Negro men and white women, to provoke acts of violence.
The idea of going into Mississippi and going into Alabama and challenging segregation so frontally is something that alarmed not only those who opposed civil rights, but those within the civil rights community.
I don't question their legal right to travel, but I question their wisdom. Some people can get hurt.
There was that feeling. I'd just like to punch some of them damn agitators right in the face.
There was a mob, looking like 1,000 people. They had these iron pipes.
They were screaming, kill them niggas, and they had babies in their arm.
I asked God to be with me, to give me the strength I would need to remain nonviolent and to forgive them.
We'll take hitting, we'll take beating. We're willing to accept death. But we're going to keep coming until we can ride from anywhere in the South to anyplace else in the South.
My parents had provided me a wonderful childhood and a tremendous amount of love and support in everything that I had done. But as a white person, I was the primary focus of most of the violence that took place because I was a disgrace to the white race. I was the traitor. So I knew if anybody was probably going to get pretty well beaten or killed, it would be me. And I wanted to tell my folks how much I loved them and how much I appreciated what they'd done.
The people who were going on the Freedom Ride from Nashville elected me to be the coordinator. That was a really heavy responsibility because the lives and safety of people whom I loved and cared about deeply, and who were some of my closest friends, depended on my doing a good job at that.
My phone in the hotel room rings, and it's the Attorney General. And he opens the conversation. Who the hell is Diane Nash? Call her and let her know what is waiting for the Freedom Riders. So I called her. I said, I understand that there are more Freedom Riders coming down from Nashville. You must stop them if you can. Her response was, they're not going to turn back. They're on the way to Birmingham, and they'll be there shortly. You know that spiritual, like a tree standing by the water, I will not be moved. She would not be moved. And I felt my voice go up another decibel and another, and soon I was shouting, young woman, do you understand what you're doing? You're going to get somebody. You understand you're going to get somebody killed. And there's a pause. And she said, sir, you should know we all signed our last wills and testaments.
Could you get on the bus?
I would get on the bus.
Yeah, today. Would you get on the bus?
I would get on the bus.
We take the conversation to the Plaza Library.
This has been a very difficult discussion to sit through because you ask, what bus would we get on? The Freedom Bus, where would we go? Being an African-American, I get on the bus every day.
We engage citizens and civil rights activists, including retired Kansas City Minister Sam Mann, who marched with Dr. King.
Which is all the more amazing when you know his own life story. He grew up in small town Alabama. His father, a traveling salesman, would stay only in motels that guaranteed a colored person never had slept in the bed. How did the Mann household view the Freedom Rides then in 1961, Sam?
Not very well, I guess. My mother and my father, they, all practical purposes, disowned me as a communist. That's what they call young white boys that didn't toe the line on the colored or the nigger issue, that's what they would call it. Pardon my use of that word, but that was the truth.
That's what they said.
So that's right, that's what they said. Yeah, that's what they said.
Reverend Mom, we're gonna go through some of these questions of where you will be taking your Freedom Ride in just a moment, but I want to bring into our conversation in the middle Mamie Hughes, former head of the Black Economic Union of Kansas City, former Jackson County legislator. But when she was growing up in Kansas City, when she went to a shoe store, the clerk curiously seemed to be out of every shoe she requested.
You mentioned the store. I go in, well, ma'am, what size shoe? You know, 4 and 4 1/2 were the sample shoe. No, we don't have any. 5, 5 1/2? Nope, don't have any. 6 and my friend with me wore size 7. They didn't have those either. And of course, since he met us right at the door, it was like, get out of here. And all of the other department stores, yeah, they would let us in, but you want to buy that, that's fine, but don't expect to try it on.
Mamie Hughes and Sam Mann are viewed of as icons of the civil rights movement in Kansas City. It was really important to me because this is 50 years ago. What difference does this make today? I wanted to bring in somebody else to help inform us today who wasn't even around when the Freedom Ride started. And Misha Beaufort Epps was willing to heed my plea to do that. She's a partner in the law firm of Shook, Hardy & Bacon. She represents large public companies and well-known privately held businesses. But again, this all happened long before you were born, Misha. What is the relevance of the Freedom Riders in your view?
For me to be able to do what I do,
every day in the practice of law for me to have been able to go to the educational institutions that I attended, for me to be able to do everything it is that I do in my day-to-day life, I recognize that it is all dependent upon the personal sacrifice of people like the Freedom Riders.
Now, I prodded and poked each of the panelists and asked them, if you were to go on a Freedom Ride today, where would you go and why? Misha, where were you heading to on this Freedom Ride today? 50 years later, where would you go?
I thought long and hard about your question. And actually, I think I would not have to travel far. Whether I was going to some of the schools here in the Kansas City metropolitan area and taking others with me to talk about some of the inequities in educational opportunities that we have here in the city. If I was taking my bus for the Freedom Ride to some of the less served areas in terms of access to health care, I could have a number of places that I could take a local bus.
Reverend Mann, 50 years later, you are heading on a Freedom Ride. And where do you go and why?
Well, I think it's a bad question.
I'm tearing it up. I'm tearing it up. It's gone. It's gone. Okay. Why is it a bad question,
well,
then, Reverend Mann?
It's you know, I thought you sent these out on the internet, and I looked.
There's nothing wrong with the internet,
no,
Reverend Mann.
No, nothing. It's fine. It's fine. I just want to be clear that the Freedom Rides were an act of civil disobedience. An act of civil disobedience that required great risk, as we saw, and. This was not a sightseeing tour. Am I messing up?
No. There's no right or wrong answers, Reverend.
One is we've got to relook at integration. I mean, those Freedom Rides were there to deal with the issue of black folks and white folks sitting down together. But we've done that. But I'm not so sure we've arrived at equality or justice. When you look at the violence, when you look at the prisons, we look at the health system, you look at our education system, integration hasn't been an answer. It's not a way to get it done. So I think if I'm going to take a Freedom Ride, I'm going to say, let's stop integration right now and sit down and look at it and see what the thing is about, because it's always black folk coming in to the white folks' house. Am I right or wrong?
Well,
you've got a receptive audience. But Mamie Hughes has something to say.
I have got to say that I would come into the hood. I would come in there where I live, and I would tell all of my neighbors or the folks around that the KKK doesn't have to worry anymore.
Oh.
They said, we're through, just go ahead. They're killing themselves. We don't have to kill them. Now that bothers me.
My bus would be to the white media and the black media in our city and across the country. After the Civil War, which many black soldiers died for our freedom, and then during Reconstruction, there were two United States African Americans in the United States Senate. Today, we have none. So I would like for the black media and the white media to sound the alarm, the shame of this century that we, at this time, have no blacks in the United States Senate.
All I can say as a representative of the media is that comment will definitely be on KCPT's air. Thank you very much, sir.
I don't know if today we would be in such physical danger taking a Freedom Ride, but on a larger scale, I think a trip to Madison, Wisconsin, or to Fox News, and...
to the Kansas City Chamber of Commerce,
to all of our Rotary clubs, where everybody builds their relationships in the business community. All you have to do is look at the newspaper and see who's been hired, when they print that every, you know. Where are the African Americans being hired in this city?
We need freedom rides into all of our banks. You go around the 3rd District and the 5th District and the 6th District and look at the boarded up houses. New plywood put on since all of this foreclosure mess started. We need those open. We need people in them. We need banks creating loans for businesses on some of these corners.
We have the state of Arizona making it legal for police to stop someone on their looks only. Now, if that isn't a place to take a bus.
There's more than police arresting people of color because they are people of color. There are children in our town who are not getting educated properly.
Correct.
Easter truth. That doesn't matter. I mean, the pain of that, you just got to look at it. Mm-hmm. Now, to turn your back on that and to let that be and not recognize the racism that's in that is worse than a policeman arresting somebody in Arizona. We got it right here. We have violence going east of truth that none of y'all really care about.
Amen.
That's as grave as the colored waiting rooms of the South. We don't deal with it. If this violence was going on west of truth, we'd be dealing with it. But the fact of the matter is, it's going on east of truth. And east of truth, life is cheap.
We teach the young people today the struggles that we had to go through to get even this far. How could we make it an integral part of our education system?
I don't think that we are doing enough to tell our young people about the successful mm-hmm. black people.
Yeah. I think we have failed to pass on the magnificent history of the black struggle for freedom.
Amen.
To our young people. Amen. I think we have failed to do that. Yes. I think we have failed to do that.
Yes, Misha?
And I mean, I think it starts with us individually.
Right.
You know, so what are we doing to educate people who are younger than us?
We have lots of young people here. Were you forced to be here by your teachers, or were you interested in this issue?
We were interested.
You were interested in this issue, they said, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, sorry, Misha.
So, I mean, and kudos to you for coming. I mean, I think part of it really means that we individually have to step up our efforts to educate others on the accomplishment of people that just don't look like you.
Misha Buford Epps, Mamie Hughes, and the Reverend Sam Mann, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Monday, May 16th at 8 p.m., you can see the entire Freedom Riders, a two-hour presentation on KCPT. You have made this a special, warm, intimate event. Thank you all for taking the time to be with us tonight. Good night.
Still to come on The Local Show, a flurry of activity at the Kansas City Sculpture Park. But first, Samaritan's Feet, a quest to put shoes on the feet of 10,000 impoverished children in our own backyard. What compels hundreds of volunteers from churches in rural Missouri to join together to bring new sneakers to students at Martin Luther King Elementary School in the Kansas City, Missouri School District? While they live only about an hour apart, there is a world of difference. As you're about to see, they discovered they all shared one unique experience and a gift that was much more than shoes.
Concordia, I think you could say it, is a really, really nice small town. I've known the people since I've been a little kid. I grew up there. The churches are wonderful. I mean, it's a really nice place to live. Yeah, I was combining corn, and I heard on the radio about a bunch of pastors in Indiana who are walking around without shoes. 300 million kids every day wake up without shoes. You know, if I can figure out a way to help out in some kind of way, that's a great thing. And I called Samaritan's Feet up, and they said, hey, you don't really want to do like 100 or 200 pairs. How about we go for 300 pairs of shoes? There's this one church that I walk in the door, and part of my spiel was going in barefoot, so I would never wear shoes. And It was like 20 degrees out one morning. There was snow on the ground. I walk into this church, and this guy sees me, and he says, "Hey, man, you don't have any shoes on." I'm like, "Yeah." And he goes, "Here, you can have mine. If you don't have shoes, you can have my shoes." I'm like, that guy gets it. He understands what this is going to be all about.
Washing the feet and getting to talk to the kids. That was probably my favorite part.
I think the best part was seeing the faces, how their faces lit up when they saw the shoes.
Oh my gosh, all about the pink.
You like pink?
I love them.
And a lot of these kids, you can tell that they are shy and they're wondering, why are we here? Because they can tell that I'm not from here, you know, I'm from the country. And like I was telling the one little boy, I said, you know, we're not really neighbors, but we are neighbors.
I think the people that I've talked to so far, they've talked about the opportunity to get outside of the small town bubble that we live in, to get outside of their ordinary existence. Like, there were a couple of my students that didn't know what Arthur Bryan's was. And so in my class, we talk about being ethnocentric a lot. And I'm like, man, if you don't know what Arthur Bryan's is, you might be ethnocentric.
Elementary school is a time, the period in your life where you have lifelong memories. Because this is such a humbling experience, someone touching your feet, how can you forget it?
The children will kick the shoes out in less than a month, but they'll remember this for a very long time.
Made the impact, I think, on everyone that these shoe distributions often do, with the mindset and the heart that the people had coming in throughout the day and the smiles on the kids' faces that brought fulfillment to all of us.
Somebody shared something with them today that most of them have never gotten before. You know, human kindness, you know, the touch of a hand that you might not ever touch before. Words from a person that you may not have had the opportunity to talk to, for them to be able to experience the same type of love and appreciation and kindness from somebody outside of their race, outside of their religious or ethnic backgrounds. I think everybody that came into this place took something of that with them today.
That report compiled for the local show by Brian Shepard, a video producer for the local investment commission. LINC is a Kansas City-based organization supporting underserved families and children in the metro. By the way, you can learn more about Samaritan's Feet at our website, thelocalshow.org. And finally, as we leave you this week, an update on one of the most talked about new art projects in the metro. In January, I traveled to upstate New York for a sneak preview of a 56-foot-tall sculpture destined for the lawn at the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art. In April, Roxy Payne's Ferment was installed and dedicated, and we were there. We'll give you a much more detailed look at the amazing process on the local show in June, but for now, here's a condensed version of what went down with Kansas City's brand new dendroid.
Thing in the morning, they're going to set the tree trunk, I understand. It'll be just like Christmas morning. We'll unwrap everything first and then decide what we do next.
The other great installation in our lawn, the shuttlecocks, I think some people will love it, some people will hate it, the debate will go on, and then it will be part of the city. It will be a signature piece of our city.
Roxy is a world-renowned artist. His piece is now among other world-renowned artists.
How's the yard man liking it?
I'm liking it a lot. You know, what's so nice is the way it sits in the space.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kaufman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.